The Pit of Ultimate Dark Shadows, Episode 8. A Long-Awaited Trip to the Passion Pit. Dedicated to Tony and Carolyn, 'cause they're so hot right now. Hello, I am Sir Simon Milligan, and welcome to the Pit of Ultimate Darkness. Tonight, we dive into the diseased human soul. Join me in studying this rainbow collection of fog. Within us are several personalities. For example, are any of us the same person when we go from the grave and back to the cradle discussing our histories with our parents? Well, we are, rather, but then they don't always like hearing about it. Just an example. You see, in the normal soul, these personalities are integrated and carrying on afresh with the most recent incarnation. However, in the freakish Collinsport soul, these personalities splinter, forming separate and distinct people, living within a single body. I know, it's a bit hard to grasp, but let us move forward. Now, join me in welcoming my brimstone baby, manservant Hecubus.
Good evening, Master.
Good evening, Hecubus. Do you have anything to add to the repertoire of the Collinsport soul?
Well, it's mainly that most of the inhabitants have indeed reincarnated, except perhaps one.
Hecubus, everyone's been someone else there at least 3 times. How can you say that?
What about your old bridge partner, Master?
Oh, him, yes. That is a bit of a trial for the old bloke. Always wrestling through a sea of familiar faces with different names. Even he has been thwarted with a split in his own personality.
You mean how he used to be the villain of this show with S&M tendencies and a completely different historical memory than what Victoria Winters experienced in the past?
Yes, Hecubus. Being stuck in a chained coffin for 170-odd years can do that to a fellow. And we must praise such a trial. It is rather evil.
And now to continue with our story of tragically uncertain continuity.
Professor Stokes and Dr. Hoffman have arrived at Wyndcliff Sanatorium, which resembles a stately home rather than the brick habiliments one would normally associate with such a place. Stokes and Hoffman await a nurse to escort him to the waiting room.
Thank you, Miss Jackson. You may leave. I'll let you know when we need you again.
Of course. I'll just be across the hall, reading my Marilyn Ross novel.
You let me know what happens, won't you?
Don't worry, Mr. Loomis. I'll give you a full report of Jan Davis's experiences.
Hello, Willie. How are you feeling?
We had potatoes today.
Really? What kind?
Mashed. But I think they said they were white.
Wouldn't they be?
Well, you see, they weren't russet potatoes. So.
Oh, you mean the potatoes themselves were white, not just the mashed potatoes.
Yeah. So it was nice.
Do you mean, Mr. Loomis, that they didn't taste like dirt?
Yeah. Say, do I know you?
We have exchanged letters.
Oh, please allow me to introduce you. Willie Loomis, Professor Stokes.
Oh, pleased to meet you. I think.
Likewise, Mr. Loomis. I have been looking forward to this.
Have you? Stokes. Wow. That does have a familiar ring to it.
Oh?
Well, let me see a minute. Let me think. Like it was someone Barnabas Collins talked about.
You remember Barnabas Collins?
Yeah, I do. I remember the old house.
Pleasant thoughts about it.
Well, I have a few.
How many?
Dr. Hoffman, please. Do you want him to count them?
Shouldn't take long.
Well, yes. I have several.
You see? Seven. He has seven pleasant thoughts about it.
I believe he said several, Doctor. That's quite a bit above a few.
Yeah, that's what I said. Several. Any number, really.
And can you describe one?
I worked on things. Antique things. Things that I had an understanding for, you know? Like the old stove.
See, Doctor? Likes working with his hands. Hands on things.
Willie, Professor Stokes and I would like to add something to your everyday routine here. Now you can say no if it's asking too much.
Ask away, Dr. Hoffman.
Would you be willing to learn, well, a new writing style?
Well, Doc, I already know how to write.
Yes, Mr. Loomis, but we're looking to help educate, or rather, help advance the technique you're currently using.
Advance? What's wrong with it now?
Oh, just a few slight alterations to help the legibility of your style. You understand.
Eh? You think what I got isn't good enough now?
Oh, not at all. Doc, why don't you just tell me? Do I got a problem with the way I'm doing it now, or not?
Come on now. Don't think I can't take it, 'cause I tell you, I can.
Willie, I...
Mr. Loomis, there is something about this that we all know.
Oh, yeah? What is that?
A man, any man, can improve himself into realms of distinction and integrity that he never assumed himself to achieve.
You see, Doc? I understood what he said. He may have said it above what you thought I could figure out. But I know it. I know what he said.
What did he say, Willie?
He said, no matter what I've already done, I can do better.
And do you want to? Do you want to learn?
Well, yeah. Sure. Why not, right? What do I have to lose? I'm stuck here anyway, right?
No, Willie, you are not stuck here.
But... what am I going to do in the meantime, hey?
Exactly, Mr. Loomis. What shall you do in the meantime?
Well, I'll find out what happened to Jan Davis and Nurse Jackson's novel. Don't forget. But aside from that?
And are you willing to work with me? Or anyone else I send to you for this?
Of course. What am I going to get anyway? Foolscap or vellum?
Huh. You... know about those?
Of course I do.
You see, Doctor, he's already aware of the intricate details in this fine art.
Is that what they call it? Fine?
All right, I admit it. You could knock me over with a feather.
Feather? Yeah. That's for a quill, isn't it?
You see, Doctor, our Mr. Loomis is going to do just fine.
And meanwhile, at the Evans Cottage, Captain Daniel Gregg and Sam Evans are waiting for Tony Peterson and Carolyn Stoddard to arrive.
Lore, that is a mighty volume.
Ah, yeah. I figured we'd have time to read it while we waited. I myself have only gotten through the first paragraph of the overture.
What's the title?
Remembrances of Things Past.
What a choice.
That wasn't the reason I picked it out, Daniel.
But still, Andre.
Say, if you do put in an appearance tonight, don't go calling me Andre while the kids are here, will you?
Oh. Yes, consider my hatch covers secure, old man. No, do press on.
I would ask myself what o'clock it could be. I could hear the whistling of trains, which, now nearer and farther off, punctuating the distance like the note of a bird in a forest, showed me in perspective the deserted countryside through which a traveller would be hurrying towards the nearest station.
Not bad, not bad. Did this book have another title?
Ah, yes. A la recherche du temps perdu.
In search of lost time. Even more fitting.
For which? The two of us? Or the people I told you about? Or the town? Or you?
All of the above. Please keep reading, my friend.
The path that he followed, being fixed forever in his memory by the general excitement due to being in a strange place, to doing unusual things, to the last words of conversation, to farewells exchanged beneath an unfamiliar lamp, which echoed still in his ears, amid the silence of the night, and to the delightful prospect of being once again at home.
Lovely. I do miss a good pipe about now. Andre, you're going to introduce me, aren't you?
If you make yourself known, Daniel, I don't have much control of that.
No, you don't.
So help me out here.
Of course.
My God. Oh, sorry. We were just having... an inside joke, of course. I can see that.
Sorry, Mr. Evans. We're a little distracted.
As well you should be. Well, come in, you two. My goodness, have a seat.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. Oh, I can't sit down. Here's the painting, all cleaned, and it looks almost brand new.
I'll say, look at that. Ah, thank you. It comes with the job, don't you know?
Ah, Mr. Evans, I've seen you do this before. But wow, this is so good. This must be how it looked the first day it was painted.
And you would know that, because?
She has that, well, you know, that, I don't know, what, that... that je ne sais quoi.
Sorry. I guess I'll need to introduce.
No need, Andre, Mr. Evans. I am Captain Daniel Gregg.
Where did you come from?
Well, as my good friend tells me, the mesosphere.
What? You mean of the underworld, or something like that?
See here, what is this? You can't be a ghost.
I'm afraid I am. But don't be alarmed. I mean you no harm.
But how can we see you? How can we hear you?
Because I wish it.
Uh-uh. I don't believe this for a moment. This must be some trick.
Oh, well, if you'd like me to prove it. Does that help?
Can you halt it as well?
Certainly.
Holy mackerel.
Well... they are a handsomely prolific type of fish. But holy? I'll have to think about that.
No, I mean... That accounts for a lot.
He's the man in the portrait. The old portrait.
That's why Mrs. Muir kept speaking out of turn.
She was talking to you.
Oh, yes. My, it is refreshing to hear someone else understand that. Poor woman. I suppose I don't make things very easy for her.
I certainly thought I'd had some surprises tonight. Ah, no doubt, Mr. Peterson, no doubt. Why? What surprises have you? Whoa there! Have a seat, you two. You both look a bit faint.
Thank you. I'm so chilled I could wrap myself in this crocheted afghan instead of just sitting on it.
I do apologize. Here now, deploy your anchors.
Don't mind if we do.
Spot of the Madeira, good fellow.
Ah, yes, here. I already prepared it on this possibility. Ah, thank you.
Thank you.
Let us know when you're quite all right. Can you pour again? I have to admit.
This is just so unbelievable.
In this town? It's not that unbelievable. Oh, well, no, sorry. I've had to come to terms with it for almost a week now. I guess I have a better grasp. Still, you two did thrust this painting on me at an inopportune moment. It wasn't until later I found out that he was attached to it.
Is that so?
Oh, yes. The captain and I have been talking a lot, and many of my cleanings were based on his knowledge, not just my expertise.
How extraordinary.
Have you calmed down?
I think so.
I wanted to know what other surprise you two had.
Oh, that one. It turned out good. My mother threw a strange man, Cassandra's brother, out of the house.
Mrs. Roger Collins' brother? Oh, boy.
Yes. You were right, Mr. Evans. With all that going on, I'm surprised we made it here on time at all.
It's true, it's true.
Yes. I've come across that oddity, as it were. Anyway, do describe this gentleman.
He appeared fairly aristocratic. Dark hair, gray suit, and gloves.
Moustache?
Why, yes, he did.
He called himself Nicholas Blair. He was looking for Cassandra, claimed to have received letters about us in Collinwood. Of course, she's been missing.
Aye, doesn't sound at all ship-shaped to me.
Hardly. How did all that come to pass?
Oh, well... What?
You were asking me?
Oh!
I smell more than the standard romance here.
Then, of course, Mrs. Stoddard walked in.
I see. Got caught necking, did you?
It was pretty good, if awkward. Mother began one of her lectures.
I'd call it an injunction.
You would! And then she gave it up in a sort of hopeless, careless fashion. And I swear, she was starting to laugh herself, until I started pointing it out.
Then a knock startled us, and that's when she opened the door for Mr. Blair. Then Carolyn went to get Mr. Collins, and he asked Mr. Blair to sign some annulment papers, rather quick, to which he became angry and was swiftly seen out the door. I can't recall a time Mr. Collins and Mrs. Stoddard cooperated so fast.
I'm not sure I've seen it either, and I live with them.
Who is this Cassandra?
She married my Uncle Roger, and then seemed to abruptly disappear. The truth of the matter is, she was posing as a complete innocent. But I'm sure she was after Cousin Barnabas. Everyone picked up on it, except Uncle Roger. Even Mrs. Johnson did.
Ah, this Cassandra. She was the one in the other painting.
I know. I'm sorry, Mr. Evans. I don't know what came over us.
I do. I saw it.
Did you?
Yes. And I'm sure you are coming to the conclusion that you did. But it always helps to make a little metaphysical suggestion. I didn't like what I saw in that painting.
I suppose we'll have to bring it back.
Good grief, no! I'd rather have nothing to do with it ever again. I'm not even sure Barnabas Collins should know where that thing is.
Now, I want us to reach an understanding.
Yes?
Everything concerning this is likely all right, but there is something I want the two of you to know, before you become further involved with each other.
Or either of us.
You don't know, do you?
Know what?
When you transferred that other painting with this one, yes?
"Yes, Mr. Evans, we did, and I'm sorry if it interfered with your plans."
"It did, and sit still, because I want to thank you."
"Thank us?"
"Yes."
"Why?"
"Miss Stoddard, Mr. Peterson, you changed paintings on me, and I don't know if you realize it, but you likely saved my life."
We did?
"A bad woman came here later looking for the painting that you took."
"Did she? Cassandra?"
"I don't know for certain who she was, but you and this gentleman here, you all changed things for us, for everyone, and I want you to know it. I was blissfully unaware of where it was. I wasn't even in my right mind, I'd say. But if I had known, I'm sure she would have done something very nasty to me. So it's a warning. If she comes looking for you..."
"Point taken."
"No kidding. So, are we taking the painting back to Gull Cottage?"
"Oh, well, I wanted to let you know. I think tomorrow is more suitable."
"Oh? How do you know that?"
"I was there earlier, and, well, let's say our Mrs. Muir is winding down from another bout of frustration with my blasted, well, her landlord. It can wait till tomorrow. To go now would be warming the bell, as it were. With what you've had to go through, I'd say some relaxation is in order. Salvage what's left of the night."
"I don't know. Collinsport can get pretty wild on a Friday night."
"Wilder than this?"
And so, if anyone was wondering what became of Victoria and Peter's encounter among the Adams family household, well, let's say they made it through the day and are now reflecting on it.
"Vicky. Vicky. Shh. Don't disturb anyone. In this house, keep whispering, if even just for me."
"All right, Victoria.
Sit down here."
"Peeking through the balustrade again, my little witch?"
"Don't be obtuse."
"Sorry, Vicky."
"I suppose all the mileage never helped us to discuss what we've been through."
"It's all right, Peter. And you're correct. I did enjoy peeking at things I wasn't supposed to, back then."
"And this time, in a much more fetching nightgown, I'd wager."
"Yes. I can't say what I wore back then I could call cotton."
"It was cotton, but I know what you mean. It was the soap, or lack thereof. Chafed me to high heaven. This century is much nicer, even here."
"Peter, I know it's been really, well, odd, weird."
"How about bizarre and disturbing? That Uncle Fester.
Oh. So he can light bulbs in his mouth. He wants to amuse. He's not like Cassandra or Jason. Gracious, I come to believe he's happier than Willie Loomis."
"I can only take your word for that."
"Peter, look at them."
"They're fencing."
"No, they're not, Peter. They're dancing. They've had 2 children already, and they're dancing."
"Well, they're dancing now. They were fencing a moment ago."
"And what difference does it make that they've had 2 children and still dance together?"
"All the difference. You and I, we've experienced 2 distinctly different centuries."
"I wish we'd talk about it."
"Let's do now. Marriages. They're not all they're cracked up to be, really."
"No, not the ones we've seen."
"Exactly. But look at Morticia and Gomez. They are terribly unconventional."
"It's true."
"But, Vicky, are you getting at the fact that they..." "Peter, do me a favor and say it."
"As strange as that couple is, they're still in love."
"Exactly, Peter. And that's what I want. I want us, wherever we go, whatever we do, I want us to have this."
"You want to take fencing classes?"
"Oh, stop. Well, you know, maybe someday. It's something to do, right?"
"Yes. What harm could there be? Could be fun. Heck, it might be handy. I think I've had a few lessons.
but never had a chance to continue.
See, there they go again.
Peter, you dear, that's it. That's why we're here.
To get marriage counseling?
No. Everything is hard to pick out and understand. There are a few things we could get used to.
Truly?
Well, what I mean is, if we know we're going to stay an allotted amount of time, we could really do this.
How long?
Well, that's just it. While we're here, we learn fencing.
From them?
Yes, Mr. Bradford, yes.
That's not...
Not what? Cost-effective? Did you think I had the funds for a proper school, not to mention the equipment?
Yeah, Dr. Lang didn't exactly leave me the world's biggest paycheck.
I was surprised he left you anything.
Me too. But I guess he must have felt pretty bad about his rotten treatment of me. A 3-year pension was nice, even if it is limited.
And my funds aren't exactly lasting either.
Victoria, do you really want to do this?
I do.
All right. You know, I can hardly resist it when you put those two words together.
For better or for worse?
And for weird.
Come on, let's go back to bed.
And along the wharf of Collinsport, if there's more than one, well, pick your favorite.
Frosty evening, and misty, and damp. Certainly not the atmosphere I'm used to.
Howdy, sugar. Looking for some company?
Oh, good evening. You must forgive me. I am looking for a woman. But I sense she... Well, what I mean is...
Nice hat. But I'm on for a different tip. What kind of woman are you after?
Well, I sense she is rather downtrodden. Perhaps even aged.
I can be that. I can be whatever you...
I'm afraid you're looking for a sailor.
What? Another sailor?
You don't look it.
No, I mean, I'm not a sailor. But I would like to reward you with some information.
That's it? Just information? I'm a bit new here. This isn't the most lucrative port on the coast, I grant you.
I'll say. In fact, I'm surprised to see any lovely ladies out here at this hour. I was told it was rather dangerous.
Oh, that. Nope. The biz has gotten better since all that bloodletting strangler nonsense quieted down.
Oh?
Yes. There were some running wolves and some crazy bats and some hawkish features roaming the neighborhood, but sources say it's easy sailing here again.
Really? That's interesting. I guess there's a few... compatriots along the wharf tonight?
Oh, looking for a party, are we?
Well, not tonight. I work alone.
And I think I would be far better alone than working with that other straggler.
Huh? Who?
Oh, don't kid me. She can't be the gal you're looking for.
Who is this lady?
She's out at the end there. And she's... not... doing well?
Hardly well at all. She doesn't even have a cane. Just a stick.
Looks like the end of an old broom.
Really?
Here. Huh? What's this for? Oh, what? That's Ben Franklin!
No kidding. Don't spend it all in one place.
I'll say I won't. Don't you even want...
Hush money.
Oh, I see. I'll be off then.
Do. Cassandra. Belphegor, show up, woman! Cassandra? Cassandra? Angelique?
Who speaks that name?
You should know me.
Nicholas? Nicholas?
Well, it's about time. Where have you been?
Falling to pieces, stupid.
Oh, really? Stupid, am I?
Give a woman a hand, you fool!
Of course, here. Oh, unholy Medusa, you smell ruinous!
I noticed that, too.
You smell like a moldy old rug and rotten wards.
Stale jars of jam, I know. Just help me along. You're used to such nasty smells, aren't you?
That's not a broomstick. What is that?
No, I'm pretty sure it's sassafras.
Oh, for those diseases.
What?
Some witch you are.
I was one once, until I got involved with...
Excuse me.
Never mind. What took you so long?
You didn't make it easy, sister.
Oh, am I your sister now? How reassuring.
So near the sea. Who did you want? Davy Jones?
Oh, Nicholas, you haven't gotten square with the times.
Oh, hush. Musical icons come and they go. Demons are eternal.
So, did you get a nice place?
I got a room at the Collinsport Inn.
What?
Oh, what did you expect? They threw me out. I know. I don't get it either.
But that family is so... so paranoid.
Apparently not anymore. And what did you think? Really? Oh, just hold on. I'm sick of this.
What?
Just take this.
Oh, thanks. Better your cane than that silly stick. What is it?
You came out here to destroy a man with a cane, and now you need to walk with one.
Oh, twist the knife, why don't you?
Honestly, woman, we do have affection for animal lust in the kingdom of hell. But really, that is all you want, and only from one person. You said you wanted to destroy him, and I know for certain that you don't. All you want is sex from that man. You don't care about anything else. Even in hell, we have standards, Angelique. And you're not even living up to those.
I know. I'm doing my best.
I knew it wasn't going to work out. I knew it from the 18th century.
You self-righteous bastard! What did you have to go on?
Your name.
How did they even pick you, anyway?
I was at the top of the list. See, we're almost there.
Good. In this weakened state, is there even anything we can do for amusement?
We can play Bloody Mary.
Play Bloody Mary? Won't that piss her off?
Exactly. You can go first.
You're such an ass, Nicholas.
Almost, my sweet. But they picked me out of Pleasure Island in time.
Aww. Yes. So evil. Well, now we head back to Carolyn and Tony Peterson, exiting the Evans Cottage.
Well, that was not just plain bizarre.
Nope. That was definitely above the average bizarre. So what do you think?
Hmm?
We could go see a movie.
After all that, you want to go see a movie?
Not specifically.
Okay, not a specific movie. Then what specifically?
How about Drive in the Woods?
Drive in the Woods? Isn't that a rather wayward option?
Well, that's the story. But the thing is, Sheriff Patterson didn't mind its being built, the better to leave deputies around the woods of it and pick up on the undesirables.
Really? So, what would you call it beyond them meeting a quota?
A new-fashioned make-out point.
Oh. Really?
Of course, if this was a date, I'm still looking for the date part. Besides, I'm so overexcited. I feel like I want...
To throw yourself into something. Me too. Still, I'm not sure about...
Though we'll likely have to pick a second feature. It's almost 10 o'clock.
Well, what the hell?
And while this romantic liaison continues, we lead you to some late arrivals at the old house. A kindly servant has assisted both his employer and a fair damsel from a bit too much at the Blue Whale.
Have a seat here. Whoop. Right there, sir and madam.
I'm all right, I think. Thank you, Wadsworth.
I shall return shortly with the tonic.
He brews the best of everything.
I hope so. I don't plan to reprimand Pop again. Never mix the grape with the grain.
That barkeep stocks a strong port.
As I've been discovering, oof. I had my rum and cola already. I don't know why I tried that, too.
Oh, dear. Don't you go falling down looking after me. Sit down here.
Thanks. It's a bit snug, but I'll take it. Well, we're a sorry pair, aren't we?
Oh, these things happen. Though, I must say, I haven't experienced it in some time.
Me neither. I think with the right atmosphere, the mild shore noise, and the right company, it does invite the spirits to flow.
Flowing spirits. I see more than one way of looking at that observation.
Huh? Well, just settle in, and you tell me all about it, eh?
Perhaps I'll try. Perhaps I shall get it right this time.
And so we depart, our couple of reacquaintance, to eventually nod off on a love seat before the fire. We leave you to speculate this as we return to our other couple who are approaching the local, yet woodsy, drive-in movie theater.
What the heck? Where's the ticket booth usher?
Maybe they don't bother with admission this late. Just a sec.
What are you grabbing? Oh, do you always keep those under the seat?
Nah, it was an appreciative client. I almost forgot about it. This will do.
What? You're leaving him a Pabst?
Why not? Ticket booth operators have needs.
Oh, try that one to the right.
What do you think it is?
Looks like a film of a music concert.
Oh, hey, is that Mama Cass?
You know her?
Well, not personally.
Oh, I think I've heard of this one.
Just music?
More or less.
Perfect or no?
Yes. Go ahead and park. Well, dodge the beer bottles over there.
Got it. What a scene. Flip on the station.
Becoming a reality.
What are you...
Rolling down the window. Just a crack.
Why?
Why do you think?
All the leaves are brown, and the sky is gray.
What is more audacious?
As of now, I just don't know.
Can we leave them alone?
No, I think we need to...
Watch over them, Master?
Well, don't let them know it, my minion. Besides, this is a good movie. 6 more songs and we get to hear Paint It Black.
I'll bet you an old bowl. Those two come up for air before that song.
An oboe? A genuine Karen oboe.
You're on.
All due respect to The Kids in the Hall, Clue, 1980s film, The Addams Family, 1960s TV show, Marcel Proust, The Mamas and the Papas, of course, The Ghost and Mrs. Muir, 1960s TV show, Monterey Pop, and musicians therein, and of course, Dark Shadows, 1960s TV show. Apologies to anyone who really loves russet potatoes.